Young's double slit experiment. The experiment that proved that light was a wave. So back in the 17th century, this guy, I don't know if you've heard of him, Isaac Newton, he thought that light was made up of particles, which he called corpuscles, which is actually just a fancy word for particles. I don't know why he didn't just call them particles, but, you know, I'm sure he had his reasons. It was Newton. So Newton published his paper on the corpuscular theory of light, and a lot of the other physicists were kind of like, no, Newton, that doesn't explain diffraction. No, Newton, that doesn't explain polarisation. No, Newton, what the heck is a corpuscle? The theory was obviously pretty flawed, but nobody had any real evidence to prove Newton wrong. And because Newton was such a big name at the time, the theory stuck around for over 100 years, until this other pretty cool guy, Thomas Young, came along with his famous double-slit experiment that went something like this. So we have our two slits, you know, double-slit. Now we're going to place a light source directly behind the two slits so that when we turn it on, the light will shine directly through the slits. So now we've got our light source, two slits, and some distance away, like a far, far distance away, we have a detection plane. And this is usually just a screen or something just to show where the light is actually hitting. Now we'll turn on the light source and shine the light through our two slits. So if light were a particle, like what Newton was saying, we should see these two really bright spots on the detection plane, right, directly in line with the slits. If you need a real-world translation of this, imagine that you have a table with a hole in it and you're pouring sand all around this hole. There's going to be a huge mound of sand directly under the hole, right? Nothing fancy is happening. The particles of sand are just falling directly under the hole or directly in line with it. Well, because light doesn't really make a mound, where the most light is hitting is going to show up as the brightest spot on the detection plane or have the highest intensity. So if light were a particle/corpuscle, we should see these two bright spots of high intensity on the detection plane, right? Well, that's not what happened. What Young saw on the detection plane instead was this. This is the part that proved light was a wave. Oh! Let me break it down. Now if we imagine light as a wave, when we turn on the light source, we'll get these waves emanating from the source. So you're probably used to seeing waves as squiggly sine waves, right? And this is convenient because this tells us the amplitude, but the drawback is that they're only one-dimensional. For this diagram to make sense, we need to see the waves in 2D because we need to see the whole wavefront. If you don't know what a wavefront is or you don't really know what I mean, I've drawn a little picture, so hopefully this helps. As you can see, my artistic skill isn't quite developed enough for 3D drawings, but the idea is to show you what wavefronts are and that the lines represent the peaks and the trough of the waves. So the full lines are the peaks and the dotted lines are the troughs. So we have waves emanating from the source. Now when the wavefronts come into contact with the slits, because of wave diffraction, the waves diffract around the slits, forming cylindrical waves. Now these cylindrical waves continue moving forward until they reach the detection plane. So now we have two sets of cylindrical waves, and because they came from the same source, they have the same amplitude, same frequency, same wavelength. What's this? Seems like we've got two identical monochromatic light waves overlapping in and out of phase. That's right, guys. We've got both constructive and destructive interference happening here. Remember how the full lines are the peaks of the wave and the dotted lines are the troughs of the wave? So where the peaks are overlapping with the peaks and the troughs are overlapping with the troughs, we get constructive interference. Where the peaks are overlapping with the troughs, we get destructive interference.
Now something a bit strange happens. We get these kind of perfect straight paths of interference. Let's take the center path for an example. If we locate all the places where constructive interference is occurring, we get these kind of perfect straight lines of constructive interference. In other words, we get these perfect lines of high intensity because the amplitude is getting bigger, we're going to have a higher intensity. And this forms a bright spot on the detection plane. Now if we look at the overlaps directly next to this path, we're going to see a perfect straight line of destructive interference. Because of the wave amplitudes cancelling out, the intensity goes to zero, which leaves a dark spot on the detection plane. So if we find all these paths of interference and follow them to the detection plane, we'll see a bright spot here, and here, and here, and a dark spot here, 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 and here. This is what's called an interference pattern, and they are totally characteristic of waves. If you ever see an interference pattern, you know that waves are involved.
I guess I could have just told you that in the beginning, but where would be the fun in that?
So you may have guessed that they're called interference patterns because they're a result of wave interference. Constructive interference causes the bright spots, or sometimes called bright fringes, and destructive interference causes the dark spots, or dark fringes. You may have noticed that the middle bright spot is brighter than the two on the side. I'm gonna leave this one up to you guys to figure out. Let me know in the comments below if you think you got it.
So there we have it, undeniable evidence that light is a wave. So you might be wondering, why don't we see this effect in everyday life? I mean, surely there must be a pair of slit-like objects lying around somewhere during daylight, right? I mean, what about sunlight coming in through my two-bedroom windows? Well, there are a couple conditions. The first is that the slits need to be around the same size as the wavelength of light for the light to diffract. To put this into perspective, red light has a wavelength of around 700 nanometers. That's over 100 times smaller than the diameter of an average human hair. We're talking about some pretty tiny slits. The second is that the light needs to be monochromatic. This just means light of all the same frequency or wavelength. You know, mono, one, chroma, color. One color is all the same frequency. You know, like red light has all the same frequency, blue light has all the same frequency. Anyway, sunlight is not monochromatic. It's made up of all the colors of the rainbow. Literally. And that's why we don't see interference patterns everywhere in everyday life. The slits need to be really, really, really small, and the light needs to be monochromatic. So the moral of this story is, you know, apart from the whole light being a wave thing, if you're ever feeling like, you know, you didn't do so well on that test, or sometimes you just don't get it, just remember that even geniuses like Isaac Newton get it wrong sometimes. Hey, I'm wrong all the time. Maybe I'm a genius. Bye guys, see you soon.